power struggles and movements, especially in the context of democracy. We'll try to understand this. In the earlier discussions, we have seen that this power sharing is very important to democracy. Very important. And how different tiers of government, like the central government, the state government, and the Panchayati Raj, etc., how this is power is being shared, and how different social groups like the, you know, the Dalits, the SC, ST, OBCs, they are given the power, or they are sharing the power, or also the males and females, or the Hindus and the Muslims and the Sikhs and the Isais, all these are sharing the power. So we'll start with that, continue our discussion, and see how those who exercise this power, or those who have power, they are constrained by the influence and pressure exerted on them. That means every time a person, he thinks or she thinks that I'm going to be a politician, he fights election, he becomes some minister or chief minister or a prime minister. So we think that this guy is having enough power, he has all the leisure, he has all the, you can say, luxury. But that is not the case. The person who is a politician or who is in the prashasan or administration, he is influenced by various pressure exerted on him, and he is constrained also. So how these pressure are being exerted? So we'll talk about these struggles that we see here and the movements. How these struggles and movements and these struggles around conflicting demands, because people are struggling for certain demands. They want something. And the pressure, this shape of the democracy. So these struggles and movements are the basic ingredient, basic backbone, or this promotes the democracy. In this and in the next one also, we will talk about, first of all, the indirect way of influencing the politics, how the pressure groups and the movements, different andolans does that. And then next thing comes is the how or what are the ways to deal with these different pressure groups and movements by forming the political parties. So as I said, you are a kid. Now you want some toy. How are you going to ask from your parents? Say your parents, you are going to ask, your parent denies. Then what you are going to do? You are going to cry. You may not be eating for one day. Okay, you may not be talking to your parents. So these are the way you are going to put your struggle or movement against the toy you want. So this is a kid asking some, or he or she has some demand asking from the parents. Similarly, you and me as a citizen, we want something from the prashasan, from the government. We want something from the government. So we will do what? If our demands are not being met or they are not being listened, we'll do struggle. We'll do movements, different movements. So how struggles around conflicting demands and pressure shape the democracy, how they create a democratic environment, and what are the ordinary citizen like you and me, which ordinary citizen can play a role in democracy, and how? Through forming different organization, going to struggles and forming the movements. But before that, let me tell you stories, different stories of two different countries. And these two are very different countries. One is Nepal, very small country, neighboring country, our neighboring country. And we don't, you know, we countries have no visas. Nepalese people work here, we work there. So, you know, we are like family. So Nepal, what happened? Nepal is the, see, we got independence around 1947 or the eras are different. Before us also, some countries got independence. After us also, some countries got independence. Now, this Nepal is a third wave. This is called a third wave country. Why this is third wave country? Because it got democracy, or it won democracy in 1990, which is quite you can say not very far from what we are living today. So that is why it is called as third wave, because it got democracy, or it established democracy after what other countries have democracy. After a long time, it got it, this one. So now the Nepal has a democracy. King Birendra, he is King Birendra. See this family? This is King Birendra's family. He is King Birendra. Now King Birendra, he accepted this power, or you can say real power of the government, and he accepted the democracy also. And he was accepting this constitutional monarchy. That is, constitution will also be there, and I will have a king status also. But the problem was, in mysterious circumstances, this family, this royal family of King Birendra, it was massacred. All were killed. This family got killed in 2001. Now, the king, or the, you can say the authority who got the new king status of Nepal, he was not ready to accept the democratic rule. King Birendra has accepted it as a constitutional monarchy. But King Gyanendra, he was not accepting it. He said, no, I'm not in favor of this democracy. And he took the advantage of the democratic government, which was very unpopular in Nepal. So in February 2005, King actually dismissed, means King Gyanendra, he dismissed the elected government. He just dismissed it, and he also dismissed the then prime minister, and he dissolved the parliament. So he took all the control, and he just removed and dissolved the elected government by the Nepal. So what would we do? Nepal will do what? What will the people will do? Because someone has come, he might have massacred the royal family, and he is now also not in favor of democracy. He wants his rule only. So now the struggle started. Nepal witnessed an extraordinary popular movement in April 2006. The movement was aimed to restore the democracy which was being ruled out by King Gyanendra. The movement of April 2006 was aimed at retaining the popular control over the government from the king. So everyone wants that the power should be taken from King Gyanendra, and now we want the power to be transferred to the elected people, that is the parliament. So all the major parties, not only the people of Nepal, all the major parties in the parliament, they forms SPA, seven party alliance, and they called a four-day strike in Kathmandu, the country's capital. Nepal capital is Kathmandu. Number of protesters, they reached there, and the protester number increased from 3 to 5 lakhs. 3 to 5 lakhs protesters were protesting on 21st April, and they sent an ultimatum to the King Gyanendra. Everyone sent the ultimatum. Also, the Maoist, they are against the government. They were using the arms, killing people they're asking the government to meet their demands. These Maoists also, they came along with this SPA. Can you imagine? The people who are against government, they also came with the government, means the outlawed government. So this happened. What this king did, he said, okay, I'll give you some concessions. I'm accepting your some demands. So he just wanted to do some daya bhav. But people, they said no. They stuck to their demand for restoration of parliament. They don't want this king pennies, like accepting some of the demands. The power to an all-party government and a new constituent assembly. Now the people wanted that. On April 24, 2004, the last day of the ultimatum, the king was forced to concede all the three demands. The king, this guy, he has to accept all the demands. Now, the SPA accepted the new prime minister, interim prime minister, as G.P. Koirala. Girija Prasad Koirala, he is this guy. Girija Prasad Koirala as the new prime minister of Nepal. And the struggle came to be known as Nepal's second movement for democracy. So we have talked about this Maoist, right? They were also in this struggle. We will tell you and we'll discuss about what we learned from this Nepal Democratic War. But before that, I'll tell you about Bolivia. Now again, these people from Bolivia. And Bolivia is a very poor country. It's a very small country in Latin America. So people here, they successfully struggle against privatization of water in Bolivia. And this popular struggle, this shows the working of democracy. How people make the democracy work. So what happened? Let me tell you the problem first. Now the World Bank, Bolivia has taken a lot of money from World Bank. Now they were not able to pay. World Bank said, okay, you do what? You give all the water supply, that is the control of municipal water supply, that is the government body, take the water supply authority and give it to the MNCs, multinational companies, Bahurashtriya company. And this happened in the city of Cochabamba. You have to remember this name, Cochabamba. Now, what happened? The government couldn't do anything. The government gave this rights for the water that has been supplied to the whole of Bolivia to this MNC, some company. Okay, the company did what? It just increased the price by fourfold. That is, if the cost was 100 rupees, they made it 400 rupees. If a person who is earning 5,000 rupees, the cost of water was 1,000 rupees. If you see, if you are earning 5,000 and you are paying 1,000 only for water, what will you do? You have nothing to do. You have to protest. You have to go against the government. You have to come on the roads like these people. So they actually did this. They came onto the roads. They demanded that this MNC should be abolished. It should be sent away. And the water control should be taken up by the government. It has to be controlled by the government. So, you know, some kind of things happened. But and the protest stopped. But negotiation failed. Nothing happened. So the police now, when the protest again started, next time the protest started in January 2000, this happened, and after that also, again the protest started. Now what police did, see, the police started to hit these people. Means the agitation, it was brutal repression by the government and the police. Then what happened? The government has to bow down because people were not ready to step back. Even the MNC people, the Adhikari of the people, the MNC, you can say the people of MNC Adhikaris, they just left. They just left the country, the city. And finally, because of the power of these people, the government has to restore the power supply to the government only. That is the municipality. And the old rates, that is the 100 rupees, not 400, were restored. So these are two very popular democracy and popular struggles in democracy. So what we saw in Nepal, let us understand these two. What we thought in Nepal, or we understood in Nepal, is the fight was to establish the democracy. Right? While the struggle in Bolivia was the elected government was there, elected democratic government was there, and the government was not taking care of the people. They were not able even to supply the water in that rate, that is the cheaper rates. They just gave the power of supplying the water, the basic ingredient, basic requirement of any human being, to the MNCs. So both these struggles were successful, and the impact was just because the people, they were involved in the struggle and the movements. So there are certain conclusions which we can draw. First, what are the conclusions we draw from these two struggles? First is, democracy evolves through popular struggles. So if somebody is struggling or fighting, not like this, but with ahimsa, without using the arms. If someone is struggling, having movements, then it is good for democracy. Democracy evolves like this, right? Sometimes it may happen that some decision is taken by the government. You talk to government and government accepts it. But sometimes the government becomes, you can say, anarchist government or Nazi type government. And they are not accepting, they are not even listening to your demand. They are just using their power and they are not listening to your any demand. What will you do? You'll do exactly what Bolivian people have done. That is why democracy becomes so important. Democracy, or you can say democratic conflict, is resolved through this mass mobilization. If there is some conflict, there is some problem, as we saw, the problem was there in Nepal, the problem was in Bolivia. So the mob mobilized. Sometimes it is possible that the conflict is resolved by using the institution we have. Say the parliament can solve it, or say judiciary can solve it. But the dispute, if it is greater, if their dispute is very, very difficult, pinch hai isme, so the resolution has to come from the people. The people has to come forward. They have to come and mobilize themselves. Then the third thing which we understood by these two different examples is, the conflict and the mobilization are based on new political organization. Like, there is a demand of spontaneity. We have seen in past also. That is, the public participation becomes very effective with the help of organized politics. So there can be many agencies, not only politics. There can be many agencies of organized politics. This includes political parties, pressure groups and movement groups. So finally, we understood that the political parties can be there, the pressure groups can be there, and the movement groups can be there. These all are the means of mass mobilization, trying to solve the conflicts and try to let the government know that what are their demands, what are their problems. So coming to this mobilization in organization, as we saw in Nepal, 7-party alliance, SPA, along with Maoist, they were against each other, they were fighting with each other, but the 7-party alliance, the Maoist also came. Then that is, this Maoist was called as Nepalese Communist Party. Now only SP or Maoist has not done it by itself. Along with this, there are other people also which came along with them. That is the labor unions, the federations, different federations, and many other organizations like the independent or indigenous people, the teachers, the lawyers, the human right groups, they all came together. Then only they represented their demands, and what demands they have represented, the government has to, King Gyanendra has to listen to it, because if so many people are protesting, so many people are in the struggle, they are saying something, the Satta Adhari or the government of Prashasan has to listen. So mobilization and organization, if you see, in Bolivia, there was no party, there was no political party in Bolivia, there was no political party who were protesting against this water privatization. Nobody said that water is the basic requirement. Without water, how can we live? If you increase the amount of water or roti, kapda, makan, this is the basic things, and water is one of the important things without which nobody can live. Without air, without water, nobody can live. But not a single political party raised any kind of demand or protest against this. So, this was led by FEDACOR. This is an organization called FEDACOR, and this organization comprised of whom? This organization has local professionals, engineers, environmentalists. This is FEDACOR. So, the movement was supported by the Socialist Party, and this Socialist Party, because it was supporting these FEDACOR and the basic requirement of water not being privatized by the MNC, so that is how this party in 2006 came into power in Bolivia. So these examples, we can see that in democracy, several different kinds of organization, they work together. Not only a particle, the political party, even an individual citizen is very important. So most of the organization, they work behind any struggle, not a single being. So these organization, they play their role in two ways. First, they can form a political party. They can join a political party. The obvious way of influencing the decision in a democracy for the government, of the government, that is the prashasan or administration, the direct participation is the first way. That is, if you say, my community is being, is marginalized, I have to do something. So I will tell you, come to politics, come to politics, be a politician, make a party, come into the election, win, and try to be a vidhayak or a corporator or say an MP, and then work for your community. So this is one way. That is, seedha chunav ladna, party banana, this is the first way. Second thing is indirect ways. Indirect ways is what? That you can form certain organization, you can form certain groups, these are called some interest groups, these are called some pressure groups, and you can make these different groups and pressure groups, and then you can ask government, because this group becomes very important when the people grows, because every politician has to take vote from someone, some pressure groups, these pressure groups also involves people, they also have votes. So this government has to listen to these groups. So what you can do, either you go directly to the politics, or you can make these interest group or pressure groups. These are the two ways. So form pressure groups or interest groups like this, or another organization, any organization you want. Pressure groups and movements. So pressure groups, as the name suggests, the groups, that is group of people who are there to apply pressure. Pressure on whom? Pressure on the administration, pressure on the government. So these pressure groups are organization. Please understand, they are organizations, they are sangathan that attempt to influence government policies. But unlike political parties, these pressure groups, they do not aim to directly control or share political power. That is, they are not made to gain any political power. They don't want to be ministers or in cabinet, right? They just want their demands to be met, whatever they have. So these organizations are formed when people with common occupation, say doctors, lawyers, with same interests, aspirations, opinions, akankshay, ichchay, come together in order to achieve a common objective. So they all have common objective, and that is why these pressure groups are being formed. Now, what we see in Nepal, we have discussed about Nepal, so that the people who came on the street, that was not pressure group, but it was called as a movement for democracy. So when we talk about people movement to describe many forms of collective actions, that is the Narmada Bachao Andolan, the movement for right to information, RTI. That is why we got this RTI Act in 2005. Then the anti-liquor movement. The anti-liquor movement in Bihar, when the women, they started a movement. After that, Bihar is now a liquor-free state. And women movement, these are all the movement, environmental movement. So like an interest group, a movement also attempts to influence politics. So the pressure groups also and movements also, they both have the same agenda. They want to influence the politics, they want to influence the government policies. So they are not taking any part in the electoral competition unlike the political parties. But unlike these groups, these movements as we see this Chipko Andolan and other Andolan we just talked about, Narmada Bachao Andolan, they don't have that formal structure. They are quite flexible. So what happened that if government came up with the CAA, that is Citizenship Amendment Act, so a lot of people came on to the street, Hindu, Muslims, Sikhs, etc., because they thought that if they don't come on the streets, there will be a problem when the NRC will come and the NPR will come, etc. So this is how the people, because of some stimulus, they came on the street. So that is why it's not so formal. It's quite informal. Let me show you some the special groups like the Amnesty International, Greenpeace, Shelter. These are the examples of proper pressure groups. So social sectional interest groups and public interest groups. So we need to differentiate between these two. Trade unions, business associations, professionals, for example, lawyer, doctors, teachers. These are some example of a particular section interest group. Usually this interest group seeks to promote the interest of a particular section. That is for trade union, mazdoors, for laborers, for lawyers. So they are only interested in a particular section or a group of society. They are not interested in everyone. Their principal concern or idea is the betterment or upliftment or well-being of their members, but not the society in general. This is the sectional interest group. Sometimes these organizations are not about representing the interest of one section of the society. So there are certain organizations, we are talking about this public interest group now. There are certain organizations, they represent some common or general interests that needs to be defined. So this second type of groups are called as promotional groups or public interest groups. So there is a difference. Sectional interest group are only interested in their sadasya, their members, upliftment of their sadasya. But public interest groups, they are interested in their upliftment also, and also the others. That is, their aim is to help groups other than their own members. That is, the basic is to help their members. But if other groups also want their help, they are there. I'll tell you an example of FEDECOR. FEDECOR, this is a Bolivian organization, is an example of an organization which started this water war. In the Nepal, we found the participation of human rights organization. When we talk about this second type, then we can give an example. This FEDECOR was, you know, meant for certain specific issues, specific community. But when we talk about the second type, then we talk about those people who are working for the Bandhua Mazduri, that is the bonded labor. So these groups fight against bonded labor, they are not fighting for themselves, but for the people who are suffering under this bondage. We have other groups of this type like public interest groups. For example, BAMSEF. The BAMSEF is a government employees union. That is BAMSEF, Backward and Minorities Community Employees Federation, BAMSEF. This is BAMSEF. So this is an organization largely made up of government employees only that campaign against caste discrimination, SC, ST, OBCs. But the whole idea is the benefit of or the addressing of problems of its member from who are suffering discrimination, but along with that they are interested in or they work for, they have concern for the social justice and social equality also, and not for themselves or their members but for the entire society. So this is the difference between social sectional interest groups who are only interested in their group, their people, and public interest group who are interested in their people as well as every other. Now coming to the movement groups, Andolan Samuha, as in the case of interest group we saw, the group involved with movements also include a wide variety. So interest group has a lot of variety. Here also movements also has a wider variety. So most of the movements are issue specific movement that seek to achieve single objective and also in a limited time frame. That is, if this is, say they want it in 1 month, so this is the time frame, and they have a single objective, like the Narmada Bachao Andolan. It is specifically meant for one specific issue. So this Narmada Bachao Andolan, this started with a specific issue of the people displaced by the creation of Sardar Sarovar Dam Bandh on Narmada River in Gujarat. So the objective was to stop the dam from being constructed, and after the dam was constructed, the problem was the compensation of the people who have suffered the displacement and all those suffrage which comes after making a dam. So these single issue movement can be contrasted with the movements that are long terms. So there are various movements. So a movement can be long term also, and it can be short term also. Narmada Bachao Andolan, as we just said, it is a movement. So because of the Sardar Sarovar Dam, it started, and for the one issue it started, but it became a wider movement. That is, it actually became a large long term movement that questioned that all the big dams which the government is planning or has planned, what is the model of development that required such dam? That is, the aftermath of making a dam is really dangerous. So movements of this kind tend to have a clear leadership. For example, in the Narmada Bachao Andolan, we have Medha Patkar ji. She is a clear leader of them and some organizations. But their effective life is usually short, but in this case, this is still going on. Let me take an example of environment or Mahila Andolan. So environmental movement is labeled for a large number of organizations, and it is a issue specific movement. It is the Paryavaran movement or environmental movement is only for environment, like saving trees, like saving the animals, saving the birds, flora and fauna. So these are issue specific movements. And there are large number. One movement is this one, the other one is this one. So there is an umbrella, you can say. The thing is that when you talk about a Paryavaran movement or environmental movement, they all have one specific thing in mind. That is, they have clear objective. That is, they want to save the environment. And that is why they are called as movement, because they, maybe the leaderships are different, people or the groups are different, but they have the same objective. So we have an umbrella movement. We can have umbrella movement. That is this is called an umbrella movement. Inside which or under this umbrella, we have various movements. Say movement 1, movement 2, movement 3. For example, we have this NAPM. NAPM stands for National Alliance of People's Movement. So this is an organization of organizations. So here is an organization which consists of various organizations. So various movement groups struggling on various specific issues, these are part constituents of this loose organization that is called NAPM. So now the question comes that how does this pressure groups and these movements, they actually pressurize the government, or how do they influence politics? Because the main idea, key idea of making a pressure group or movement is that only. So first is, they try to gain public support and sympathy for their goals and their activity to carrying out information. That is, how do they do it? They do campaigns, they organize meetings, they file petition, and they also try to influence the media. Media means the newspapers, the TV channels, and other medias. They are this, today we have social media also. So they try to influence these. They try to call them and show them that what they are doing, so that their voice may be heard. If you see here, she is Medha Patkar. And as I said, that there are certain organizations which are umbrella organization under which we have various organizations. Now, the second way how these pressure groups and movement exert influence is they often organize protest activity like strikes and disrupting the government programs. Because if they are disrupting something else, nobody is going to listen to them. Government is not going to listen to them. So if they stop the train, if they stop the buses, then the government will be it will be pressurized to listen to their demands. Then there are business groups, big business groups like the Ambanis, Adanis, the Tatas and Birlas. So they often employ professional lobbyists or sponsors, or they can have a sponsor expensive advertisement. Now, how does this happen? Can you imagine Ambani going to the Prime Minister or the Cabinet and asking for something? No. Ambani will hire, because he has, you know, he is the richest man of India. So he will hire some lobbyist, and these people will go to the government and they will ask for the favor in whatever way, because the Ambani is providing a lot of, this rozgar, employment, and also it is giving the boost to the economy. So now the lobbyists are there who on the account of or for the favor of these industrialists and big people, these lobbyists, they ask for the favor. In certain instances, the pressure group are either formed or led by the leaders of political parties, or they act as extended arms of political parties. For example, there are certain political parties, I'll just come to this, but there is one more thing before I go to this point. Political stance, there are various groups, these movements and groups, or the, you can say, the pressure groups, they take a stand on certain issue. They have political ideology and political position in various major issues. This is very important. Now, coming to this point, which I said that political parties have a hand above, or you can say they are favoring various groups. For example, almost all the trade unions, all the student unions, all these organizations, they are either established by the political parties, or they are political parties, or they are affiliated to the political parties. For example, NSUI is student wing of Indian National Congress. Then ABVP, this is the student wing of Bharatiya Janata Party. So that is how this, so most of the pressure groups generally we see in the school, colleges, the universities, and in the offices like trade unions, they are subjected to, they are affiliated to these political parties. Sometimes we have seen that the political parties grow out of a movement. So if some movement is going on, for example, take this example. Now this is Assam Gan Parishad. Assam Gan Parishad, how was it formed? These were students. They started agitation, they started the movement to stop the foreigners, illegal immigrants coming to Assam. When this movement ended, then these people, these students, they formed a party, Assam Gan Parishad. And when the election happened, this Assam Gan Parishad, they won the elections. So this is how they made this Assam Gan Parishad. This came out of movement. If you talk about DMK or AIDMK, these parties also came out of the movement that happened in 1930-1940. And this was totally based on the social reform. And it is not that these movements or special groups, they always oppose the political parties. They don't have any kind of, it's not always like that. these people, they talk to the political parties or the government. So they have a dialogue, they have a negotiation. So movement groups have raised new issues that have been taken up by the political parties. For example, this is a political party one, this is a political party two. Now this political party is in government, this political party is in opposition. So this political party which is in opposition, this is government, opposition will take the issues of the groups, various groups and pressure groups, etc., and try to pressurize the government if they find it better for to win the election. So sometimes political parties grow out of movement. If you see, all these are because of movements also. Now this important question comes is, how do you see this? Does this pressure groups and movements, they influence in a bad way? Are their influence unhealthy? First of all, it may appear that it's not healthy because they are actually pressurizing the government to meet their demands. But if they are doing it and it is available to everyone, that is, everyone can do that, it's not a bad thing. A democracy has strengthened because of these pressure groups. So pressure groups, if I can give you an example, governments can often come under pressure from small group of rich and powerful people. Okay, so they are, as I just said, Adani and Ambanis, they can put pressure on the government and the government can come under their pressure. But when we have the pressure groups and movements, government will think before doing anything which is against the normal citizen. So putting pressure on the ruler is not unhealthy activity in a democracy, as long as everyone gets this opportunity. Because whenever this kind of thing happens and pressure groups and movement happen, then the government has to see the needs and concerns of ordinary citizens. They can't just see these big people. I'm not saying that the government should not think of them because they are actually helping the economy. Then comes the public interest groups and movement perform a useful role in countering the influence and reminding the government that what are the needs and concerns of ordinary citizens, as we just saw. So if, say, one group, it is pressurizing the government, group one, it is pressurizing the government, then there is another group which has to counter this, there may be another group. So there are different viewpoints that the government get. So the government gets to hear about what different sections of the population want. And this is only the democracy. When government thinks, understands, and listens to everyone, this is the democracy.